There is the whispering of war in eastern Ukraine. Videos posted on social media show convoys of military vehicles arriving in the Donbas region. Kyiv has put its troops on high alert and is employing new weapons in the field. Washington is considering to send warships to the Black Sea, while Moscow is moving heavy weaponry, including amphibious forces, to the border. The ceasefire that remains in place is fragile, with frequent violations coming from both directions. Making matters worse, the events are accompanied by increasingly belligerent rhetoric. Though much of the military buildup is occurring distant enough from the Ukrainian border that an immediate invasion seems unlikely, the events are nonetheless close enough to set nerves on edge. I'm your host Shirvan and welcome to Caspian Report. Today's episode is sponsored by Conflict of Nations, a free online strategy game set in the early 21st century. At the core of the game is a real-time system that places you in control of a real country. You must manage the economy, enlarge your army, while researching new technologies to gain an edge over your opponents. Military units are moved across the map in real time, allowing for a deep level of strategic planning. A game round usually takes a few weeks to complete, and you can play against up to 128 players, with world domination being the ultimate objective. Since I'm a fan of diplomacy, I like setting up coalitions with other players to contain emerging powers. Now, I've set up a special round of Conflict of Nations for the first viewers who download the game from the link in the description, and I will share the details at the end of the video, so stay tuned. Sitting at the center of the European plain, Ukraine has historically served as an invasion highway going east and west. The wide and open geography, mainly consisting of flat and fertile plains, is inseparably linked to that of its neighbors. This geographic distinction is rooted in the lexicon as well. Ukraine means borderlands, and it has consistently served as a geopolitical buffer in one way or another. Centuries of East-West contention has left a deep impression on Ukrainian society. In the West, Lviv is strongly pro-Europe, while the eastern cities of Donetsk and Lugansk identify as part of Russia. The capital Kyiv, situated in the center, is tasked with maintaining a balance between its internal divisions, a mission that hasn't been easy. Today, the EU and NATO, championed in particular by Poland, consider Ukraine a place where Russian influence can be confined. The promotion of opposition leader Navalny, the sanctions against Russian industries, and the overall anti-Russian narrative in the West all serve towards this geopolitical end. For Russia, the stakes are even higher. The European plain, which extends into Belarus and Russia, is largely indefensible. From the easternmost edge in Ukraine, it is only about 750 kilometers to the westernmost coastline of the Caspian Sea, with the city of Astrakhan marking the most strategic anchorage. This territorial gap, often referred to as the Volgograd Gap, is fundamental to Russia. If some foreign power were to gain influence in Ukraine, that power would gain the ability to steamroll through the flat Russian countryside and block access to the Caucasus, the Black Sea, and the Caspian Sea. From there onwards, the very existence of the Russian Federation would come under question. And this isn't just some theory. During World War I, the Germans sought to gain control over Ukraine to exploit the Volgograd Gap and force Russia into capitulation. During World War II, the Germans tried again and made it as far as Stalingrad. Russia fought tooth and nail to push the Germans out. Clearly, the security of the Volgograd Gap is non-negotiable for Russia, and it's one of the most critical considerations in Russian geopolitics. So Russia sees Ukraine as an irreplaceable buffer against the West, which explains its support for the pro-Russian separatist forces in eastern Ukraine. Since 2014, the armed conflict in Donbas has claimed more than 13,000 lives and displaced millions. the line of actual control froze in place when separatist forces backed by Russian troops pushed the Ukrainian army from the Donetsk airport and the city. Ukraine was left humiliated, routed, and suffered significant casualties. At the time, it was unclear whether the separatist forces would push deeper into Ukraine, so the leadership in Kiev opted for a truce. French and German officials brokered a ceasefire agreement known as the Minsk Protocol. The objective was to prevent the Donbas conflict from spilling over into the wider region. In this regard, the Minsk Protocol achieved its purpose. However, diplomatic efforts failed when lawmakers tried to use the same protocols as a roadmap to a lasting resolution. Kiev is lobbying the West to eliminate the separatist forces in Donbas and push Russia out of Ukrainian territory. The hope is that this formula would one day be applied to Russian-controlled Crimea. Meanwhile, the separatist leaders in Donbas say they want to be part of the Russian Federation, a sentiment supported by the local population. Russia, however, has different priorities. It is less keen on annexing the Donbas region and more interested in constitutional autonomy for the separatist territories, which would grant Moscow significant influence over Kiev in the long run. The Minsk Protocol does not provide the mechanisms to reconcile these vastly different objectives, and therein lies the problem. Since the deadlock, Kiev and Moscow have mobilized troops, tanks, missiles, rockets, etc. towards their borders. The military buildup on both sides is now greater than at any time since 2014. Not surprisingly, this has prompted whispers of war. Now, officially, Moscow recognizes the separatist regions in Donbas as Ukrainian territory and is committed to their reintegration into Ukraine. In practice, the Kremlin has taken significant steps to render any future reintegration efforts futile. For example, in 2019, Moscow began the fast-track distribution of Russian passports to residents of the separatist region. This weaponized citizenship strategy is steadily transforming Donbas into a passport protectorate and paving the way for open-ended Russian intervention. Even if Ukraine could regain nominal control over the region, the large number of Russian passport holders would provide Moscow with endless justifications to intervene and deny Ukraine full sovereignty. Allowing Donbas to turn into a passport protectorate would freeze the conflict without end in sight. So, it is in Kiev's interest to act sooner rather than later. Closer to home, both in Kiev and Moscow, there are additional motivations to escalate tensions. President Zelensky's approval is dropping rapidly. According to one poll, a little more than a fifth of Ukrainians would vote for him in 2021. Those are not good odds. Putin has a similar dilemma. While previously, in 2017, 59% of Russians named Putin a politician they trusted, in February 2021, only 32% expressed trust in Putin. In the same duration, Putin's approval rating dropped from 70% to 48%, with a staggering 41% of Russians saying that he should step down. Some kinetic exchange might just be enough to shore up domestic support. The point is that both parties have reasons to exploit the tensions in Donbas to appeal to their respective domestic constituents. But for argument's sake, let's imagine the resumption of hostilities not just in Donbas, but along the larger spectrum of Ukraine versus Russia. How would it play out? Well, first off, in spite of the military reform efforts by Kiev in recent years, not much has changed in the balance of power vis-à-vis Moscow. The Russians have the capacity to rout their Ukrainian counterparts. And as the greater military power, Russia could go about its strategy in different ways. It could conduct small incursions along the entirety of the Ukrainian border. Doing so would spread thinly Ukrainian firepower over a large area. What makes this scenario feasible is that it would require very little effort on Russia's end. On the downside, the minor incursions would not yield additional political or security leverage. Another option for Russia and its patrons in Donbas is to expand the separatist lines into the remainder of the Donetsk and Lugansk provinces. This would make the separatist entities more self-sufficient, but it would only add between 50 to 100 kilometers of buffer space to the Volgograd gap. That is not nearly enough, especially not considering that such a push would encourage even more pro-Western sentiment in the Ukrainian society and warrant additional sanctions that Moscow cannot afford. The third option for Russia would be to drive along Ukraine's southern coastline and the Dnieper River to link up Donbas with Crimea. Going for such a land bridge would strengthen Russia's hold over Crimea and Donbas, while also securing the North Crimean Canal, which, going by pre-conflict data, provided for 85% of Crimea's freshwater needs. That said, the supply lines along the land bridge would be stretched thinly, not to mention exposed over a distance of roughly 400 kilometers. This wouldn't be a problem for Russia as long as regional powers do not engage in the fight. Otherwise, those Russian supply lines would likely collapse and the whole thrust would fail. But if no outside power intervenes, a land bridge that connects Donbas with Crimea while anchoring by the Dnieper is an ideal outcome for Russia, even if it were subject to additional sanctions. Now, technically, Russia could push even further. It could seize the entire southern coast of Ukraine and connect to the Russian forces in the separatist region of Transnistria in Moldova. In this scenario, Ukraine would be crippled. It would lose access to the Black Sea, thereby downgrading its alliance with Turkey, and the loss of the port city of Odessa would inflict substantial damage on the Ukrainian economy. From Russian perspective, a continuous arc along the Black Sea would secure most of its interests in the region. The trouble is that the Russian military would be severely exposed west of the Dnieper River, and foreign intervention past this point is almost certain. From a geographic angle, if Russia were intent on invading Ukraine, the perfect point for anchorage would be along the Dnieper River. In the context of the European plain, the Dnieper is one of the few rivers wide enough to bestow tactical advantage. There are only so many crossings available or even suitable for bridging operations. Seizing all of eastern Ukraine and controlling the crossing points over the Dnieper would allow the Russians to focus on certain choke points. It would grant Russia a far more secure defensive frontline than the buffer space in Donbas. Yet, taking such a vast chunk of territory would instantly provoke a zealous insurgency movement which may prove difficult to pacify. The cities of Kiev, Kharkiv, and Dnipropetrovsk would be particularly troubling hotspots. Additionally, taking all of eastern Ukraine would guarantee covert and overt foreign interventions, as well as maximum pressure sanctions by the United States, as seen in the case of Iran. Clearly, this is not a position Russia wants to be in. Putin could lose every inch of leverage he has thoroughly gathered since his presidency. Ultimately, things are unlikely to mount to the point of all-out war. Mostly because not much has changed in the Ukraine-Russia equation, at least not from a military-political angle. Ukraine still lacks the capacity to fight Russia, while even now the United States is content with the current stalemate. Germany still doesn't want anything to do with it, while France remains de facto allies with Russia in other domains. Turkey and Poland have beefed up their support for Ukraine, but they still lack the resources to change the status quo. Russia, meanwhile, continues to persist for constitutional autonomies than outright annexation. So, in spite of all the hype, the resumption of large-scale hostilities is improbable, though it cannot be excluded because of the number of heavy guns near the border. In all likelihood, Donbas will remain in a state of limbo. because in political negotiations, diplomats will often act very open-minded about new things as long as they're exactly like the old ones. I've been your host Shirvan from Caspian Report. If you approve of our work, please leave a like, comment and subscribe. That helps with the algorithm. Now, to join the special game round of Conflict of Nations, just click the link in the description, type in Caspian Report in the search bar, and enter the same Caspian Report for the password. You'll be helping out our channel by doing so. When using our link, you will also get 13,000 gold and 1 month of premium subscription for free. The offer is available only for 30 days, so click the link, choose a country, and fight your way to the top. Thank you for watching, and Sahol.